The Deep End team acknowledges the traditional owners of the lands on which we work and live, pays respect to elders past, present and future, and recognises the importance of Indigenous knowledge to informing public debate.
A no vote is not a passive vote. A no vote is not saying, look, I'm not quite sure, so I'll stick to the status quo. A no vote is an active choice of rejection. And so is that generally what you intend to do or mean to do?
Zali Steggall is the sitting member for Warringah in the Australian House of Representatives. She has been the independent member in this previously ultra-safe Liberal seat in Sydney since 2019, when she defeated the then incumbent Prime Minister Tony Abbott. She's Australia's most successful alpine skier, winning a bronze medal in Slalom at the 1998 Winter Olympics and a World Championship gold medal in 1999. She became a practising barrister, specialising in commercial law, sports law and family law in 2008, and was appointed to the Court of Arbitration for Sport in 2017. Zali has also served as an independent non-executive director of the Winter Olympic Institute of Australia and a director of the Sport Australia Hall of Fame. She received an Australian sports medal in 2000. She presently convenes the Warringah for the Voice Network of Volunteers and Community Groups.
Thank you, Zali, for joining us. So we're here on Bunurong Wurundjeri land at the Melbourne Conservatorium of Music on our South Bank campus, and we're absolutely delighted to have you join us here today, Zali. Aaron Korn, Director of the Indigenous Knowledge Institute, is one of the hosts of this podcast, along with myself and our wonderful producer, Patrick Telfer. So, of course, the question of the moment is the fate of the referendum question on which Australians will vote on October 14. Will Australians vote for constitutional recognition of Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander peoples as the first peoples, and that recognition would take the form of the voice? And I know you're very familiar with these issues and you've been campaigning hard with all of us to convince our fellow Australians to vote yes. So Zali, tell us first of all a bit about yourself and your electorate and your role in the parliament.
Thank you. Thank you for having me, because I think you must be exhausted but determined to continue and to get as many people informed as possible. And I would like to also pay my respects to traditional elders of the land on which I'm coming to you from. But here it's contested, so it's a little more difficult to pinpoint particular tribes, but still an incredibly rich history in our local area in Warringah and around Mossman and Manly. And in fact, Manly Beach, where obviously Philip landed, and so some have said where initial kind of injury was caused because of the spearing of Philip at that point. But incredibly strong support here in Warringah. I am obviously an independent politician. I've come at politics. I'm not a career politician. It's my third career from international sport, where I was incredibly lucky to represent Australia at four Winter Olympic Games and actually make sporting history by winning a medal and winning world championships. I then went on to be a barrister, where I did do a little bit of native title law, some land and environment, commercial sports law and family law, and then decided to come to politics because I felt that we needed more merit-based policies in politics, and we needed more competition, more diversity, less of the two major parties, and more community-based representatives, so as an independent. For me, this debate has I approach the voice and the Uluru Statement in the sense that it is such an incredibly gracious invitation. When you think of our history, Australia's colonial history, the dispossession and the disadvantage, the incredible, it's just such an incredibly generous invitation in light of that history, and a long, long overdue step of reconciliation. And for me, what I really feel the primary reason to support is that constitutional recognition that 65,000 years is such an incredible cultural legacy and opportunity for Australia. And when I think of our own lives are so short, you know, in the whole history of things, and when you go and see carvings and you see remnants of Aboriginal history in the rocks, and I do a lot of bush running, right? So I see a lot of these. It's so incredibly grounding, and it really sort of makes you pause and think about the magnitude of our planet and our land compared to our own small little lives. And I think that is something to be celebrated and recognised. So for me, there is that kind of the emotional reason for supporting it, but then there's also the practical that I think the outcomes will be so much better. And as an MP, I have often looked in the last 4 years to get that impartial feedback or advice in relation to proposed laws, and it's incredibly hard to get it when we've had legislation that's particular to particular Aboriginal communities. If I go to the government of the day, I'll get the political response of that political party, and if I go to the opposition, I'll get their political view. It's very hard to get the view from people on the ground who can genuinely tell me the merits of the proposed policy. So I see a huge practical advantage in having the voice to the executive and to parliament.
Wow. I hadn't even thought of that, Zali. You're the first guest we've had on the program to actually raise that point, that when you go seeking advice under status quo arrangements, under the way things are now, it's just not there to be found. It's all party political, right? It's all filtered.
Absolutely. And a lot of people have raised this question of, you know, there's already 11 Aboriginal Torres Strait Islander members of the Senate or of Parliament, and so why should there need to be an additional representation? Those members of Parliament represent their parties. They are there on party tickets. And so we know on both sides there is very little speaking out against the party ideology and policy line. So you just don't get to the bottom of an issue of really genuinely feeling whether or not this is a policy that is good, sound, merit-based policy versus a political opportunity, or, you know, what are the motivations behind it? And so I've confronted that for the last 4 years, where it's just incredibly hard. And, you know, in the last parliament, I spoke to Ken Wyatt around the policy and I got his view, and then I talked to Linda Burney and I got the Labor view. But it was very hard to get to the bottom of, on the ground, who actually spoke on behalf of the community. And that just wasn't there.
Mm. I think it's safe to say that as members of the voting public, we've kind of noticed that.
Yeah, look, one of the things that I've found fascinating is I actually spent a lot of my childhood growing up in France, which is why a manly girl became a ski racer. Probably explains a lot. But I spent years in France learning about English history and French history, and you learn about medieval history, you know, you learn about everything. And I came back to Australia and I was just shocked at how little of Australian history we learned. I'm definitely of that generation where we did not learn about the frontier wars. We did not learn about massacres, about dispossession, right? We didn't learn about slavery in Australia. And I think that is part of the problem now, maybe with the referendum, is people genuinely, other than younger generations who now get more exposed to it, there are too many that did not get taught the reality of Australia's history.
Hmm. So given the historical status of your electorate in Australian history, as you pointed out before, it's where the First Fleet landed. How are people in your electorate feeling going into this election from the work that you're doing and networking with them?
Look, I've been really pleased to see the level of support. I've taken to the last two elections my support for the Uluru Statement and for a referendum and recognition and the voice. So I've stayed true to my platform when it comes to the elections. But the support has really been growing and really been very strong. We have now over 700 volunteers actively door knocking. I think we're at about 12,000 doors knocked. We've had volunteers letterbox dropping. We have had four forums with, you know, 500 to 600 people attending at the first one, and then several hundred more. We've done online webinars. The support has been really strong. We've had volunteers manning market stalls down in Manly, up around Mossman, and there on the ground, anecdotally, the support is a good two-thirds positive, so 6 to 7 out of 10 are very positive. And Manly is a very busy place with a lot of tourists and a lot of hospitality, and people come from other areas of Manly as well. And last weekend I did walk through the jazz festival with Linda Burney, and that was, you know, really good because we saw people from all over Sydney that were there for the festival, and the support and the overwhelming sentiment was positive. So I have absolute faith that Australians will come out strong in support. I think, you know, it's not often we get tapped on the shoulder for an opportunity to write the next chapter of Australia's history. And I think it's really important that people recognise that and really be brave to take that opportunity.
Mm. So that's great to hear that you're sounding positive about this. It's actually quite refreshing, actually. So I thank you for that. And I think, you know, there are really good people out there doing really good work at this time, and there seems to be a lot of doom and gloom, but, you know, we all know that polling can be very, very wrong, of course. How about, just let me think, I did have a question there and we'll...
Truth in advertising, political advertising.
Oh, there was somewhere else I wanted to go before that, and then we'll come to that. It was...
Can I say, to give everyone a bit of a sporting analogy, of don't let polls and the negativity wear anyone down? Because I know it's easy to start. That is why they're doing it. I have no doubt that the clear strategy is to have a constant barrage of negativity and feed doubt into the outcome to try and get people to be less motivated, less engaged. And I think, you know, it's really important to stay focused. You know, in sport, you take the start line, you don't know what the outcome's going to be. Mm. You have to do the work, do the preparation, give it your best shot, and know that you're not leaving anything behind. And I think that's what the Yes campaign's doing. You know, you can only worry about what you can control. And so that's, I think, the most important part for everyone, you know, really fighting hard for this opportunity and this change, is to be focused on the positive, right? We've got to focus on what we can say, what we can do, and know that regardless of the outcome, we've given it everything. And I really want to commend everyone, and in particular Marcia, you know, incredible, incredible contribution to Australian history in all the effort that's gone into the last few months. And whatever the outcome, it is an incredible moment in time.
It is. We'll look back on this moment when our kids ask, oh, what did you do during the referendum campaign? And we'll have quite a story to tell. And I think, you know, actually being on the right side of history is, you know, a good thing to be able to tell our children and our grandchildren.
I do share your optimism, Zali. I have great faith in Australians. I really do. I think that the distance that Australia has come as a society and politically in the decades that we have been alive is quite immense and quite positive.
Absolutely. But also, I think, remember, traditional media does not have the sway over people that it used to have. If I could give the comparison of independence at election time, we have the might of the traditional media thrown at us, pretty pretty clearly, and plenty of doubting and plenty of polls saying it's not possible. And then it is possible, because at the end of the day, it comes down to the individual conversations, it comes down to the grassroots movements and people prepared to be out there. And that is representative of communities. Of course, I don't know what it's looking like in WA and Queensland. You know, this is where it gets really hard, because you can't control what's happening, the message in other places, but I do feel it's shifting, and part of the No campaign is about this desperate desire to retain the status quo, to retain power, and to retain kind of that control over information and how policy is designed. I really see all this very interlinked. This objection to the voice is part of this old school, it's an era that has had its time, that is gone, that is going. Whether we can show that it's gone now or it's going to take a little bit more, I don't know. But I do think the tide has shifted, and modern Australia is quite different.
So we wanted to ask you about your commitment to truth in political advertising, and what your views are on how the often egregious lack of truth in some of the campaigning to oppose the referendum proposal will play out in our democracy.
Yeah, it was the lack of regulation around misleading and deceptive advertising, so lies in political advertising, really shocked me. It started in 2019 when I came into politics, and I was absolutely stunned to see that there was no really regulation, no protection. And having come from being a barrister in a commercial environment where goods and services and businesses, all of their advertising is regulating, you know, you have misleading and deceptive advertising is caught, consumers are protected, and yet voters are not protected. And we know misleading and deceptive advertising really erodes faith in democracy and trust in outcomes of elections. And we saw that to its worst extreme at the 6th of January uprising in the US in 2021 after the election. And so for me, absolutely, I've been pushing for truth in political advertising, or stop the lies, since 2019. And the government, so the Labor Party, were very supportive in opposition. They've indicated their support of it now in government, but unfortunately have been really slow and, I think, complacent and arrogant in failing to enact this quick enough. I retabled my bill, Stop the Lies, amended to ensure that we had truth in referendum advertising as well. And this is not new law. This is law that's been in effect in South Australia for 20 years. The ACT has now covered it as well. It is a process. It works. It works in the commercial environment. It's about being able to assess the veracity of facts being claimed. You can still have people expressing opinions, but you can't have something presented as a fact if it is misleading and deceptive. Now, unfortunately, the government voted. I tried to suspend standing orders in Parliament to ensure that we could debate my Stop the Lies bill to have this in place for the referendum. The government voted that down with the coalition. They have since committed to implementing truth in political advertising at the end of the year as a result of the inquiry into the Joint Standing Committee did an inquiry into the 2022 election. But I'm a little bit cynical, because we know both major parties have used this to their advantage time and time again. In the 2019 election, you had the desk taxes campaign, scare campaign. In 2016, you had Mediscare from Labor. So both sides have used this loophole or lack of regulation for campaigning. You know, I call it fear and smear. That kind of negative campaigning is something major parties like to do a lot. And it draws on people's fears, and it presents scenarios that are just not factually correct. Of course, we see also the advent of social media and the growth of fake news and deep fakes, which is where people can create complete fake manipulations of somewhat of anything that's on the public domain, and we have no regulation in Australia to deal with that. So urgently needed. The question is, will the government stay true to its commitment and promise to do it? So Minister Don Farrell has indicated they accept the recommendation of the committee to implement truth in political advertising, but I'm a little sceptical because I know there is negotiations on foot around reform, around elections and donations, and I know the Labor as well want to do a deal with the coalition to have bipartisan support to do legislation that may well block more independents being able to get into Parliament and a bigger crossbench. And I am worried, genuinely worried, that the government will compromise on truth in political advertising to get the coalition over the line in those negotiations to try and embed the status quo of the two major parties. So I think for everyone out there, all the listeners, anyone who cares about truth in political advertising, it's going to be really important to keep raising this. And we've seen with the referendum campaign just how damaging it is, because you just get this embedded lies and distortion of what the facts are, and these lies get promoted and repeated and repeated, and they do take hold, that they have effect on people, and it absolutely erodes democracy.
I'm very interested in this area of cybersecurity and cyber fraud, both the technical and social aspects of it. It's something that I hope we'll come back to in future episodes. So it'd be good to talk to you about that again in the future, and even bring other sorts of experts on to, you know, describe it more in detail. I know for a fact that there are people who really don't have the ability to discern between what is real news and what is an algorithmic bot attack.
Mm-hmm. But we also have in our system, you know, embedded protections and allowances for news. So keeping in mind, I'm all for freedom of speech. You know, I think the press is a really, you know, the fourth estate is a very important pillar of democracy. But with those freedoms comes great responsibility. Mm. And currently our media, for example, media ownership, publications, all those standards are self-regulated. We have codes of conduct and codes of ethics that are self-imposed and regulated. We have an exception to the Privacy Act for news and for media. We don't have a tool of privacy, right? So we have a lot of allowances for news and journalism, which in a democracy that works really well, it's healthy, it's good, and it's important. But if it doesn't have the checks and balances to make sure it's not being abused, and things like misleading and deceptive information, lies, deepfake, all of those aspects, it will erode the trust in democracy. So it's very important. So I'm very keen to look at this in the context, obviously, of the truth in political advertising when it comes to the referendum. I think it's been incredibly damaging, and it was a mistake of the Prime Minister not to legislate this before the referendum got underway. I tabled my bill in February, so there was plenty of opportunity to do it. But it must be addressed moving forward, and it will be really important to see whether that happens or not. And then, of course, it's that responsibility of the media in exercising its privilege responsibly.
I'm alarmed, by the way, at the Australian Electoral Commission pamphlet that's gone to, it must be 17 million households now, because I understand that's how many people have been enrolled to vote in this referendum. And the fact-check services tell us that the yes case is correct and factual, and the no case published in the Australian Electoral Commission pamphlet is substantially false or misleading. And so here we have a referendum paid for by the government, a very costly referendum about an issue of national importance, in my opinion, and yet the AEC is forced to publish essentially falsehoods because of the lack of regulation that you've pointed to. And I think this is going to be not just damaging to our democracy, and I'd like to hear more from you about that, but also what I'm very worried about is that so many lies have been told now that it will take years for us to correct that misinformation and to correct the disinformation. So I just saw one today that was published in the Daily Telegraph. Muslim women reportedly claiming that they were told at their mosques that if they fill in yes on the ballot paper, the government will deny them family reunion rights. So this is how low the no case is going. And I'm and you know, of course, there's the big lie from your old nemesis Tony Abbott, who says that the annual Indigenous Affairs budget is $30 billion. Well, that's just outright nonsense. It's nothing like that. And, you know, the figures that are published by government are highly misleading in any case.
Absolutely. And I can assure you, having pored over the budget papers, you know, for the last 4 years on a yearly basis, that is not the number. And I think it's incredibly, I mean, it's just appalling that an ex-prime minister just openly lies in that way and that the media report and platform those lies. But what you're saying about the AEC pamphlet is I'm horrified. And that was why in February we were agitating with the government to enact the law to change the situation so that you could have fact-checking, at the very least fact-checking of the pamphlet, because essentially the no case in the pamphlet is an opinion piece, right? It is an opinion piece from those who voted against holding a referendum. That is who is authorised to write the content of the no case in that pamphlet. It is not based on any facts. It is based on opinion. But it's not presented as opinion. It's presented as fact on an official document paid for by the taxpayer. I think it's an incredible indictment on our system that we have taxpayer money funding a booklet to every household in Australia that contains lies. It's when people come to understand that, and when I explain that to people, they are quite enraged that that's the situation. It absolutely needs to change, and I think that's where the pressure has to be on the government, that we can't allow this kind of misinformation to continue unchecked. I mean, we have legislation being considered around social media platforms, but ironically Facebook and a few others have been more proactive in using RMIT and fact-checking than the government or the AEC. So that's quite an indictment as well. But that, look, the brochure, I think the only saving grace is that brochure is so nondescript and I don't think it's the most impactful piece of document that people are going to receive in their letterbox. But what's frustrating is then people are not getting access to the legitimate arguments for the change, for the referendum and for constitutional recognition.
Well, I'm sure you're aware that we on the referendum working group, on the referendum, opposed the publication of the pamphlet, and we wanted the obligation under law to publish that pamphlet, removed by amendment. We were ignored by the government on that point, and I think they might reconsider their views on this in the future. Because what a huge strategic mistake they've made in ignoring our advice on that. And actually, to go to our motivations for not wanting the pamphlet published, we were thinking, oh, there'll be about 14 million voters. This paper will go to 14 million households. It'll be an enormous environmental pile of waste. And most people won't read it. So I do hope you're right that it's, as it's turned out, it's not very attractive, I remain concerned about the environmental waste involved. But now we have, you know, the added problem. It's a huge financial waste, and we always thought so. And what's the government doing paying for law and allowing lies to be told when they're just, you know, not serious enough to change the legislation to require truth in political advertising?
Or at the very least, fact-checking.
Yes. And so another one that we were ignored on was, paying for the campaign. So we said, no, absolutely not. Don't pay for the campaigns. And it's true that, you know, the government has said that they're not paying for any campaigns. But it does look very odd, doesn't it, when the government is out campaigning for the yes case and they're telling the no side that they're not paying for any campaigning. So, you know, I think there's quite a mess to sort out there. I think the public's quite confused about that.
Yeah, look, and it's been interesting as an MP. I mean, essentially the government has, you know, there's no support to get additional information out to our electorate. So, for example, I have had to fundraise directly to my community to pay for hosting webinars and putting on town halls like big forums. Our budgets as MPs does not pay for us to book venues. We have to fund that directly ourselves. So I've had to fundraise to be able to provide, I think, a legitimate information and opportunity for my community to ask their questions and get access to information. And so it has been really interesting to see this. Yes, on one hand, the government supports it, but are not funding it, and then expecting individual MPs to do it. And then there are, I mean, I guess there's no restriction. I mean, for example, I know that some Liberal MPs have paid their used their communication budget to push and pay for advertising on, for example, Facebook of misleading and deceptive material from Advance Australia, right? So taxpayer money is pushing third-party organisation lies. I find that quite wrong. You know, that an MP can use their comms budget for their own material, I can understand, but for pushing the material of a third-party organisation, I think that's quite an unusual one as well. So, and I think then some communities are left with the difficult situation that their access to information heavily relies upon their local MP or the organisation, and depending on, I guess, party membership of their MP will really determine what access to information they get. I mean, the only thing that I guess reassures me a little bit is the support on the ground in terms of volunteers for the Yes campaign is so overwhelmingly bigger, greater. I do feel on the 14th of October and over the next 2 weeks when pre-poll will be on, there will be a much greater number of Yes volunteers to answer questions and provide information to people to hopefully help people make an informed decision of their choice.
Yes, those volunteers are wonderful. I've met many of them on my own campaign trail, which I personally am paying for in many cases. Sometimes people who are hosting me pay for some expenses, but I have noticed everywhere that I go that the volunteers are so enthusiastic and so committed, and I'm really grateful to them, because if it weren't for them, how we feel even about this campaign, let alone the outcome, would be a much sorrier affair. So many thanks to those volunteers. But you make a really interesting point. To what extent in the future will we be able to enjoy living in the kind of democracy that we're accustomed to, or at least we're accustomed to before the advent of algorithms, bots, the import of, you know, American far-right politics into the No campaign, the mustering of, well, some of them aren't even far right. Some of them are just not quite sure what the right word to use is, but, well, there's a level of lack of rational thinking in many of the claims made.
There's a lot of conspiracy theorists.
Conspiracy theorists, yes. So, you know, I think the way that this referendum's been conducted, you know, under our laws and strategically will make us think very deeply. We heard from Anne Toomey that she fears that if the referendum fails, our constitution will be frozen and you know, the undesirable outcome, the unintended outcome is that it will be left to the courts and the parliament to interpret our constitution rather than have the, you know, the people's sovereignty that we have at the moment through the referendum process. And beyond the problem that she's pointed to, that our constitution will be frozen, we have, I think, we face a crisis of democracy because of these features of this referendum. Do you think I'm being too alarmist?
I think there's... No, I do agree there are grounds for concern, but I also look at signs to say that we are on a better track. So we have got a distinction with the US electoral system where we have compulsory voting, and it does mean that the vast majority of the sensible centre comes out and votes. Unfortunately, what we know when you look at the US politics is it's usually the more fringe believers who are more, I guess, incensed or motivated to vote, and those more in the middle that are sort of going along about their lives that are less likely to engage in voting and politics. So I think what we have in Australia is that extreme kind of campaign and populist far right of Trumpism has more difficulty taking hold because of our system of compulsory voting. So I'm at least that's something that Australia has done really well. So I'm glad for that. But I think if you look at the last election, you know, a third in primary vote, a third of Australians voted for Labor, a third for the Coalition, and a third for alternate parties and minority parties and independents. So that says the status quo is shifting. This is not, our politics are not frozen in this adversarial, you know, two-party system. We have got potential to move the dial, to modernise and, I think, grow up a little bit as a democracy and become more competitive and a bit more collaborative. So I really hope that we can continue down that path, because that's what we need for a number of issues, whether it's this and constitutional recognition or whether it's our climate change policy or, you know, better integrity and accountability in politics. So I think we need to keep progressing those issues. What's interesting, though, what you were saying about those fringe elements, I do think they foster in the dark, and that they have once a strategy exposed is a strategy more neutralised. And so exposing it is really important, exposing who are the people behind, what's happening, what their motivation is. And it is all linked to this desire to hold on to power, to hold on to decision making, to hold on to the old ways, or, you know, the status quo that has worked so well for certain socioeconomic groups and certain, you know, cultural groups. And opening that up to more diversity is not in their interest. And so they do everything they can to hold it back. And I see that across so many policy areas, not just this issue with the referendum. So I do hope that we have... that our democracy can be robust. Ultimately, it is about people understanding the power of their vote. If there's one thing I've seen in Parliament for the last 4 years is one thing MPs all care about is their job. And they will do a lot of things to get votes, and they ultimately come back and want people to support them to get their vote to be in the job. what they're less happy with is traditionally is accountability in between, right? And so pulling back the curtain on what happens in Parliament and the process of how our laws are debated and how they are determined and how government operates is really important, you know, for people to have that civic education of understanding the process. This is your democracy, it's your government, your vote makes this happen. And so you can change it if you're not happy with it. And I think that's ultimately what the grassroots independent movement's about. So I am concerned about the referendum, the impact of this on us. I think this potentially is a bit like a Brexit moment for Australia, where the true ramifications and significance of the outcome could dawn on people down the track if they have been misled into what, you know, what they believe is the right answer on the 14th of October. But I do think we have an incredible I do ultimately have trust that our younger generation is open and wants a more modern, progressive Australia. I say to a lot of people, the Constitution was written in 1901, mostly by white men, right? Women were not consulted. Indigenous people were certainly not consulted or counted or recognised. It was a power-sharing arrangement between state governments who agreed to form a federal government but didn't want to give up too much power. And so it sets out the power sharing arrangement between what powers a federal government will have versus what powers the state government keeps. It doesn't have detail, but it was never intended to be frozen in time. This is not a document frozen in time. It is meant to be a document that can be progressed and modernised to reflect a modern Australia. It has very hard mechanisms to modernise it. The referendum mechanism are complicated. The double majority requirement is difficult. I'm okay with that because I think difficult means it can be respected and it's robust, but it's not impossible. So I don't know if I completely agree that it means we have a constitution frozen in time. I think it's just we need to keep educating Australians to this is a mechanism available to us to modernise our constitution. Yes, it is an expensive process, but I think it's wrong that we've had 20 years without a referendum, right? I think that's really damaging that it's taken from 1999 to 2023 to have another referendum. This is a mechanism within our democracy. This is here for Australians to use. And whilst expensive, it is still a part of our democratic process. And the more Australians engage with that, and maybe the more often we have an opportunity to do it, we will then be less... certain elements of our communities might be less reluctant to think of the Constitution as a document that can be progressed and amended and updated versus some Bible that's frozen in time that can't possibly be touched.
You just remind me, how many amendments are there to the US Constitution now? There are lots. They're all numbered. I don't know enough about US history to know
that. I probably don't know enough about the US Constitution.
No, I don't either. I don't either. But you know, I mean, there's certainly a reverence for those amendments, isn't there? You know, like they're actually enshrined. They're considered to be the real deal. They're not do-overs. They're, what's the word that we've been using? They're enhancements. Well, look,
I have in many of my forums shown photos. I've done talks to a lot of Year 12 students because they need to go and register to vote, and their first vote is going to be this referendum. So this will be memorable for them. And so I've wanted to make sure that they understand the opportunity and the significance and how it all works. And showing students, you know, that it was horse and carriage and a very different mode of dress and a very different Australia when the Constitution was written in 1901, highlights the fact that this is not automatically a document that reflects modern Australia.
Mm. Well, that is a very useful and I think welcome ray of hope in this debate, Zali. Thank you very much for sharing that. So for people who are genuinely undecided as they walk into the polling booths on the 14th of October, between now and then, What would you say to those people heading into this referendum?
I would say understand that a safe vote is actually a yes vote. Because rejecting change is not safe. Because a no vote is not a passive vote. A no vote is not saying, look, I'm not quite sure, so I'll stick to the status quo. A no vote is an active choice of rejection. And so is that genuinely what you intend to do or mean to do? As opposed to, look, I can understand or I accept certain aspects. I'm just worried or concerned about unintended consequences. And to those people that are doubting for those reasons, and I have met many of them that doubt because they're worried there might be unintended consequences, I would say have faith in our parliamentary system to sort those problems out. Have faith in your vote, because your vote will elect the next government that will likely be in effect before the outcome of the referendum is really into full effect. And so have faith in our democracy and parliamentary system to put in place the mechanisms necessary to make this work. But ultimately, at the heart of this is if you accept that constitutional recognition is important and necessary, which most people do, I should say, then you have to think about, do you want that recognition to be tokenistic, or do you want it to be meaningful? And if you want it to be meaningful, then you have to agree to respectfully do it in the way that's been asked, which is by having a voice.
So, Zali, thank you very, very much. Wonderful discussion. Yeah, you've enlightened me about a number of matters.
Yeah, lovely to talk to you.
Thank you. I look forward to being able to meet in person. But can I just say, Marcia, thank you so much for your tireless advocacy. You've inspired a nation. And if there's a positive that's come out of, I still think the positive will be a yes vote, right? I'm very focused on this. You never take the start line without believing you can win. But I also feel like it has raised the profile and the education, the level of education and awareness in Australia of incredible Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander leaders, which for too long have not had the recognition they deserve. I know we've often recognised people on the sporting field, right? and I was very pleased to see Adam Coons and Cathy come out, but I think for too long we haven't recognised the incredible other contributions and other leaders that we've got in our community. And so thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks, Starley.
You know, I do compare it a little bit with climate protests and climate demonstrations and marches, where it's shifting. This is shifting, absolutely, and whether we will see whether it's shifted enough, but it will shift. It will keep shifting, I think it's because it is actually intrinsically linked. A lot of where we talk, people that are very focused on climate policy and the risks of global warming and acknowledge that incredible custodianship and care of country that First Nations Australians have done for so long. And then you look at our impact over such a short period of time. Non-Indigenous Australia has a lot to answer for.
It's kind of a no-brainer, isn't it?